In 2010, experts began to notice a worrying change in Apple's financial reports. They had suddenly stopped making all of their money in the U.S.
And we turn to a side of the tech revolution that rarely gets attention. How much do our leading tech companies pay in taxes?
Apple could be about to feel the wrath of the European Commission, which is set to accuse the U.S. tech giant of benefiting from illegal Irish tax deals.
It turns out good old Apple might owe Italy around, €1 billion in back taxes.
This shift prompted both EU and U.S. Senate to launch detailed investigations into what Apple had done. And it was these investigations that indicated to the public that Apple may have sidestepped the law in its quest to maximize profits.
You swear that the testimony you're about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth, so help you God.
I do, so help me God.
Since 1980, Apple has had an R&D cost-sharing agreement with our Irish subsidiaries. Our cost-sharing agreement, which is common in the industry, is audited by the IRS, and we are in full compliance with all laws and regulations.
This agreement shifted the economic rights in your crown jewels to three Irish companies that you own and control. And so $100 billion plus is now stashed away in these three Irish companies. I'm not saying it was legal or illegal. You've told us in one place, I believe, Mr. Cook, that you do not intend to bring those monies home unless our tax rates...
Senator, there's a lot there. I'd appreciate being able
to... You can, but I just want to ask you that one question. Is it true you told our staff you're not bringing the $100 billion home unless we reduce our tax rates? Is that accurate?
I don't remember saying that.
Is it true?
I said I don't remember saying...
No, I'm saying, is it true that you're not going to bring them home unless we reduce our tax rates?
I have no current plan to do so at the current tax rates.
Okay. With that, we're going to move to our third panel. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
It was a sham. It was a purely an accounting maneuver, but it was an accounting maneuver that allowed Apple to take profits that were properly attributable to the U.S. and just move them to Ireland. The reason that was helpful to them is that Apple had made a sweetheart deal with the government of Ireland to get an especially low tax rate, where they'd pay tax rates of 1% or even less.
Down to tax haven.
Yeah, I think by any meaningful definition of the term, it is. The government will tell you that technically it's not. But if you have any meaningful definition, i.e. a country which facilitates aggressive tax avoidance by big multinationals such that they end up paying tiny amounts, virtually no tax on their enormous profits, then we are a tax haven.
Apple had been shifting billions of dollars of profits to Ireland and paying little to no tax thanks to their sweetheart deal. But the EU ruled that this deal was in fact illegal state aid, and they dealt severe repercussions.
The European Commission has today adopted a decision that Apple's tax benefits in Ireland are illegal. Apple now have to repay the benefits worth up to €13 billion plus interest.
These companies would say they're doing everything they can within the bounds of the law. Our tax laws are the way they are almost entirely because of a relentless lobbying effort by companies like Apple. Some of these laws have been essentially written by the companies themselves. Like, they'll give the statutory language to members of Congress and say, this is what we'd like. Companies like Apple have special access to Congress, have special access to the process of changing laws. That doesn't make them above the law, but it does mean that they have the capacity to effectively change the laws in ways that they like. And that is profoundly disturbing. Really, what it means when $47 billion of tax that Apple should be paying doesn't get paid is, you know, it's got to come from somewhere else.
With the United States facing a record deficit, Barack Obama has unveiled a $3.7 trillion budget with spending cuts and tax hikes at its core.
We're going through the budget, program by program, item by item, line by line, looking for areas where we can save taxpayer dollars.
Meanwhile, the U.S. administration has announced significant budget cuts.
The agency's facing cuts. The Environmental Protection Agency, the State Department, the Agriculture Department, the Labor Department, Health and Human Services, and the list goes on and on.
In the long run, that's what's happening. All this revenue loss is coming out of something that we'd all really like to see, like structurally sound bridges and roads, a good education system, a healthcare system that we can all rely on. All of these important services are incrementally eroded by tax avoidance on this scale. Everybody loves their iPhones, and so it's easier for people to fall so in love with their iPhones that they don't really want to think about what else the company is doing. The responsibility for corporate tax avoidance by Apple and other companies can be laid at the feet of a compliant Congress, politely passing whatever bills the corporate lobbyists want them to pass. But part of it also has to do with the public. And we need to get to a place where voters care enough to find out whether the companies they're patronizing are really good citizens of the world.
Apple's corporate tax avoidance shows no sign of slowing, and the real-world implications of this are felt across the globe. This friendly company with innovation and care at its heart is using these loopholes to take the money away from its customers in the places it could truly make a difference.
It's funny, I remember when I moved here, I actually thought I was gonna sort of cover the downfall of Apple. And like a lot of people, I figured, you know, the iPhone was pretty saturated, right? Anyone who wanted a smartphone had one at that point. And it wasn't clear to me how Apple was gonna continue to eke out profits. And of course, they've basically doubled in valuation since then. And I realized that all the assumptions I had were just, you know, totally backwards. The power of the ecosystem is really just beginning to be understood, I think.
Which smartphone is in your pocket right now?
Got the iPhone 10.
Oh, there it is.
There it is.
Sometimes it's hard to break away from that ecosystem.
What is it about this ecosystem you're talking about?
Judner, you're next, man. The pressure's on.
iPhone 10.
Wow, it's just two phones so far.
I'm gonna be straight up. It's iMessage, man, in the ecosystem.
Whoa.
That's what it is for me.
The Apple ecosystem describes the way that different Apple products integrate seamlessly with each other. With Messages, for example, Apple uses the internet rather than cell towers and is able to display messages across your Apple Watch, MacBook, and iPhone with no delay. The more that you buy into the company, the more you are let into this ecosystem.
The Apple ecosystem is designed in a way that everything must go through Apple. Now, whether it's apps, whether it's services, or even the way that currency is transferred through Apple devices, Apple potentially takes a cut from everything that happens. When you think about apps that you buy on the App Store and you may be paying $2 or $3 for that application, not all of that goes to the developer. Apple takes a piece of the pie along the way. This comes from music, this comes from their iBook store. In every facet of Apple, there is something that they do capture along the way. What Apple has done very well, to their credit, is that they're holding suppliers within that agreement, within that ecosystem.
Apple knows that it has a captive audience in its ecosystem. So if the new iPhone doesn't feature that many improvements, it's hard luck, because you're going to buy it anyway. If you don't like the fact that the MacBook Pro has fewer ports than it did years ago, it's tough luck, because you're going to buy one anyway.
You could be sort of happily locked in a sense, right? I mean, it's nice when your Apple products work seamlessly together. The trouble is some of the antitrust implications there, wherein, you know, if I want to use a smartwatch that's not Apple, it doesn't work as seamlessly with Apple. And it's not just because they're different systems, it's that Apple actively makes it difficult for other products that aren't Apple to work with the iPhone.
Today we're announcing Apple Music, the next chapter in music, and I know you are going to love it. It will change the way that you experience music forever.
Apple's both the gatekeeper to its ecosystem, and it makes products for that ecosystem, right? So Spotify has complained for years that, you know, Spotify has to pay 30% of fees to Apple when someone signs up through the iPhone, and then Apple comes along, basically takes Spotify's idea of streaming music platform, introduces its own, gives it a higher ranking in the App Store, calls it Music. So there's lots of instances like that where Apple is a competitor and a gatekeeper to the App Store. And there's a conflict of interest there that just favors Apple to some extent, ever so slightly, and to some extent in a way that can feel existential if you're a developer.
Thank you for the opportunity to offer testimony. At Apple, we make ourselves a promise. As Steve put it, we only make things that we'd recommend to our family and friends. You can try to define this difference in a lot of ways. You can call it the seamless integration of hardware and software. You can call it simplicity of design or a great ecosystem. All of those things are true. But if you want to put it simply, products like iPhone just work.
Let me ask you this. Apple requires all app developers to use Apple's payment processing system if those developers want to sell their goods or services to Apple users through Apple's App Store. Isn't that correct?
That is correct, because it's
by processing payments for apps that you allow into the App Store, you collect their customer data and you use that data to inform Apple as to whether Apple should, whether or not it would be profitable for Apple to launch a competing app. Isn't that correct?
Apple has come under massive fire for antitrust. That's been one of the big battles that the company has been fighting over the last few years. It really has felt, reporting on Apple, that there has been a new antitrust case every day in a different region. South Korea, Italy, America, the UK, you see it everywhere, that they are all going for different areas. But the big thing is the App Store, because the argument is that the App Store is controlled by Apple. Not only does Apple take up to 30% of every purchase on the App Store, but it also controls which apps are allowed to even be there, which has led to the argument that they serve as a gatekeeper for the platform.